This is Joey Pusateri bringing you peace and grace from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And we continue our Bible study with the Gospel of Matthew chapter 12. And we'll be looking at verses 38 through 45. Then some of the scribes and Pharisees said to him, meaning Jesus, "Teacher, we wish to see a sign from you." But he answered them, "An evil and adulterous generation asks for a sign, but no sign will be given to it except the sign of the prophet Jonah. For just as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the belly of the sea monster, so for 3 days and 3 nights the Son of Man will be in the heart of the earth. The people of Nineveh will rise up at the judgment with this generation and condemn it, because they repented at the proclamation of Jonah. And see, something greater than Jonah is here. The queen of the south will rise up at the judgment with this generation and condemn it, because she came from the ends of the earth to listen to the wisdom of Solomon. And see, something greater than Solomon is here. When the unclean spirit had gone out of a person, it wanders through the waterless regions looking for a resting place, but it finds none. Then it says, 'I will return to my house from which I came, for when it comes, I find it empty, swept, and put in order.' Then it goes and brings along 7 other spirits more evil than itself, and they enter and live there. And the last state of that person is worse than the first. So will it be with this evil generation." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God, and let us now go to God in prayer. God, we thank you for this time that we can study your word. We hope that the seed of your word and the seed of your truth will find depth in our souls, and that will bear good fruit for the kingdom of God. We ask all these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. All right, this portion of the story of the Gospel of Matthew, I think, might be one of the less well-known. I know that this isn't a passage that I usually hear read or preached, and in fact, the lectionary, which is the calendar of reading that a lot of churches will use to structure the proclamation of the Gospel throughout the year on a 3-year cycle, does not include this passage. So it kind of has 2 different sections. The first section is the sign of Jonah section, in which the scribes and the Pharisees ask Jesus to show them a sign. Now, a couple things that we want to notice is, number one, here the scribes are added to the Pharisees, which we saw in the previous sections, as those who represent the kingdoms of this world and stand in opposition to Jesus and the kingdom of God. So we see this increasing opposition, this increasing tension and conflict. And if you remember in passages that came before this, it says that the Pharisees began to conspire to destroy Jesus. Now that's important, because when they come to Jesus and say, "Teacher, ask, teacher, show us a sign," we know that that is not an earnest request. That those aren't, these are not people who genuinely want to see a sign from Jesus. It's almost like a taunt or a dare or an entrapment, because we already know that they're seeking to destroy him. So we can't take this desire for a sign on face value. We know that there is probably something underneath that. And the way that Jesus responds is to draw upon the allusion of Jonah. And we remember the story of Jonah. Jonah was a prophet, and God comes to Jonah and says, "I want you to go and to preach against Nineveh, this, you know, wicked city that has been condemned." And Jonah goes in the opposite direction. And as Jonah goes in the opposite direction, he ends up being thrown overboard in the middle of a storm. He goes to the bottom of the sea. He is swallowed by a giant fish. And then he is eventually vomited up on the shore, finds himself in Nineveh, preaches against Nineveh, and then Nineveh miraculously repents and is saved. And so Jesus is drawing this allusion to say that here's the sign that I will give you, my death and resurrection. And he says, in the same way that Jonah was swallowed up by a beast, that he also will be swallowed up for 3 days before he arises again, which of course is the resurrection, and that will be the sign. So this is a message to all generations that come after this, that the choice is ours to believe, and the sign that we are given, there is no sign greater than, of course, the crucifixion and the resurrection. So if we're not willing to take the resurrection as a sign of the identity, the power, the authority of Jesus, then there's probably nothing that's really going to convince us. And that's kind of the thrust of what he's trying to say here. Then he goes on to talk about return of unclean spirits. And it's a strange passage that says something along the lines of when a unclean spirit has gone out from somebody, then it will go away and then it will come back and find the person empty. And when it comes back and finds the house empty, as it will, then it will bring with it seven other spirits more evil than itself. So this is a condemnation of any generation that rejects Jesus, that doesn't accept him and his authority. And what it's saying is that, you know, Jesus can come and say, cast out a demon. You know, and metaphorically, that is to say that Jesus can come and provide healing. You know, perhaps the church comes into your life and helps you restore order in your life and helps you cast out the demons of addiction or adultery or unholy living or whatever it is. Let's just say that somehow, in some way, the power of Christ comes into our lives and does a good work and tosses out all of that which torments us. If we don't fill the proverbial empty house, once the demons have been removed from our lives, if we don't fill that space with faith in Christ, if we don't accept him for who he is, then in essence we're leaving that house vacant. And if the house is vacant, then it is going to be filled not only with the demons that were there before, but with many other ones, sometimes more evil than the one with which we used to be afflicted. So it's important that when we cast out, or we have had the help of the church, or the power of the church, or the power of Christ, cast out those things in our life that had been tormenting us, that we fill that void and that gap with something else, lest those evil things return to our lives. This is a great principle that you would find in, say, 12-step recovery. People who have recovered from alcoholism or drug addiction or any other kind of addiction, they will usually tell you that it is so important to make sure that you fill your life with something positive. So now that you are no longer going to bars or meeting with certain kinds of people or living a certain kind of life, it is important to fill it with other things, to fill it with service to other people who are suffering, to fill it with positive recovery, you know, to go to 12-step recovery meetings, to spend time in prayer, to live the kind of life that fills the void. If you have somebody who is separated from drugs and alcohol and they don't really add anything else to their life, nothing positive or healthy, then usually what you find is that addiction will eventually return. Okay, I hope that is a useful, practical message from an unfamiliar passage, and I also hope that you have a wonderful and blessed day. Take care.